Periods of intense speculative activity are often accompanied by expanded market participation and a large influx of new investors. In fact, many economic models explicitly characterize how the behavior of inexperienced investors can drive and sustain speculative bubbles. At the same time, the available empirical evidence has been largely anecdotal. This paper addresses that gap and provides some of the first systematic evidence on the causes and consequences of investor contagion. What factors draw new investors into a booming market? And how do they generally fare relative to their more experienced counterparts? To answer these questions, the authors study individual investor behavior during the recent US housing boom and bust. After rising spectacularly over the 2000s, US housing prices collapsed back to their pre-boom levels by the end of the decade. Previous work has established that speculative activity helped fuel the boom, and that a substantial fraction of homes in this period were purchased as investment properties. That is, they were not purchased to be used as a primary residence, but to generate financial gain. For example, by being quickly resold or flipped for a profit. Against this backdrop, the authors ask whether inexperienced investors were infected by observing the activity of other investors. In particular, they investigate contagion at the neighborhood level. Did having a neighbor who invested, or seeing a nearby property get flipped, make an individual more likely to become an investor? The paper uses data on nearly 5 million housing transactions in the Los Angeles metropolitan area between 1988 and 2012. This figure shows the dynamics of the market over this period, including the dramatic boom and bust of the 2000s. Now, the key challenge in this setting is that people living in the same neighborhood tend to be similar on many dimensions, and this likely gives rise to similar investment behavior. In other words, correlated investment activity within a neighborhood may reflect simply that, a spurious correlation rather than causal evidence of investor contagion. To overcome this, the authors use a nearest neighbor approach in which they test whether individuals are influenced by investment activity that occurs within a block of their primary residence, while controlling for similar measures of activity in slightly larger bands. The rationale is that an individual may prefer a certain neighborhood, but their ability to live on one particular block within that neighborhood is limited by which houses are on the market and available at the time of purchase. This means that while similar individuals tend to live in the same area, this sorting occurs at the level of neighborhoods, not individual blocks. These figures show how this insight allows the authors to estimate the causal effect of local investment activity. Because sorting occurs at the neighborhood level, differences between homeowners and their neighbors increase only gradually with distance. But over the same spatial scale, there's a sharp increase in the relationship between exposure to local investment activity and a homeowner's decision to begin investing when that exposure occurs at very close distances. These contrasting patterns allow for the estimation of hyperlocal contagion effects while netting out broader neighborhood correlations in behavior. And the results show that these contagion effects are substantial. The presence of each neighbor within 0.1 miles that begins to invest in housing increases a household's probability of also investing by 8% within the next year, and by 14% over 3 years. the presence of a nearby flipped property increases the same probabilities by 9 and 16%. These effects are large, and they likely underestimate the true magnitude of investor contagion. Because this strategy estimates the relative effect of hyperlocal investment activity, it does not incorporate the impact of activity that occurs farther away, or that individuals may be exposed to via other channels. Beyond the impact on individual behavior, contagion also matters for market-level dynamics. The results suggest that neighborhood contagion accounted for 10.3% of new investors over the course of the Los Angeles housing boom. Again, incorporating sources of contagion lying outside the 0.1 mile radius would increase this number even more. Finally, how did infected investors ultimately fare? Several pieces of evidence indicate that they performed worse than all other investors. First, they earned lower returns on the properties they bought and sold. This is due to a combination of buying at higher prices, selling at lower prices, and suboptimal market timing. Relatedly, they were more likely than others to hold their properties past the peak of the boom, and were more likely to go into foreclosure as prices fell. This suggests that these individuals were substantially less sophisticated than the more general population of investors. Thus, over the course of the housing boom, many inexperienced investors entered the market as a direct result of observing nearby investment activity, and these infected investors performed poorly on average. Among the mechanisms that drive contagion, social learning is likely to be an important factor. Witnessing investment activity close at hand may lead individuals to update their beliefs about the market, and there is evidence that neighbors share practical investment tips. While further work is needed to explore these channels, the findings here show that investor contagion can shape the dynamics of speculative bubbles. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include many papers on the dynamics of bubbles and financial crises, those focused more particularly on the role of investor contagion and herd behavior, and finally, papers on peer effects in investment decisions.